Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa. Buddham dhammam sangham namassami. So this morning, as every Saturday morning here at the monastery, the Sangha has gone on alms round. Alms round is this practice that has been done since the time of the Buddha. Monastics every day, and it still happens definitely in places like Thailand and Burma and Sri Lanka actually as well, where monastics will go to town with their alms bowls, and whatever is offered to them, that will be the meal of the day. So sometimes we practice like that every day. Sometimes we don't have the opportunity to go to town, so people come and offer food to the monastery. But in however way it happens, it always happens. The Sangha will only eat what has been offered. And it's part of being this practice of generosity that of 2,500 years, where people that are born Buddhist will offer food, but also any stranger who feels so inclined to make an act of generosity. And so this morning we went to Union Square, to the city where we used to go on alms round back in the day before we moved to New Jersey, before the pandemic started. And we were greeted by this morning by many different people from so many different walks of life, but also a lot of Thai friends actually from the Thai community in Queens. And for a moment actually I felt like I was in Thailand actually. There were so many Thai people, so they kind of turned Union Square in you know, a little little glimpse of Thailand for a few hours, where they were, you know, lots of different families and children and teenagers and adults were stopping and offering food, and at the same time showing others how to do so. And it was so interesting how the practice of generosity is so contagious, once that other people had perhaps no idea who we were and what we were doing there. And the alms bowl sometimes can look like a drum. So in the past, people asked us, you know, who were not Buddhist, they're asking us where they could buy one of those drums. But as the offerings today were so abundant, it was very clear that it was not a drum, but a recipient, something that was there open to receive offerings. And so it was interesting how then, you know, we weren't speaking English, we weren't speaking Thai, we weren't speaking any other language, but we were speaking the language of generosity, which is a language that is international. And how then this robe doesn't become anymore the robe of a Buddhist monk, but it actually becomes the vehicle through which one can practice generosity. The field of merit actually that the Buddha talks about in the suttas. He talks about the Sangha as being a field of merit. And sometimes when we first encounter these words, we can be a little bit perplexed and kind of not quite understand if we're not born in that culture. But when we are actually experiencing the magic of generosity, then it doesn't become anymore, you know, a cute word in the suttas or an abstruse, you know, paragraph, but becomes this powerful lived experience. Powerful way to understand really the power of giving, the power of letting go. Sometimes in Western circles, when we get into meditation practice, you know, there's a lot of talking about letting go, but it's more forceful letting go. It can be actually very, very stressful sometimes. It's mainly, you know, about meditation practice. So a lot of it is, you know, trying to get back to the meditation object that we have picked, and letting go of our thoughts, letting go of our cravings, letting go of so many different things. And then it can be quite challenging, or like we can be also very hard on ourselves and like, well, I have so many degrees and have so many accomplishments, but I can't even like stay a minute focusing on my breath and my in breath and out breath. Such a loser. And you can get into these, you know, breathing Olympics. But if we start actually spending a lot of time with people that are born Buddhists, see that a lot of times actually lay people hardly even meditate. Yet they have so many times mastered actually in at least certain respects of the Dhamma, of letting go. They have mastered letting go. And so we see how the practice of generosity is just not something, you know, that we might see as, you know, something perhaps ritualistic or something that a chore. Okay, well, maybe it's part of the Noble Eightfold Path, so at a certain point I need to give this thing. Well, so much dukkha, actually. I'd rather have it to myself, or you put it there. Actually, it becomes a practice of joy, and we see that the more we give, the more we're happy. So today we were showered by all these, like, the most incredible offerings. It's such a humbling experience, actually, to wear these robes. And so people, whether they were purchasing things at the market or they had brought offerings from home and perhaps, you know, spent the morning, early morning, cooking food and giving it to the Sangha, it was not, you know, like, oh, I had this kind of thing laying around in the kitchen and I don't really want to eat it, so I'll give it to these renunciants, to these beggars. But rather it was, what is the foremost that I can offer? What is something that they would appreciate? So they knew that some Western monastics were there, so they had gone out of their ways to find some pizza. It's very cute. But yeah, also the sort of best dishes, best Thai dishes that they had put so much care in putting. Yeah, so this incredible, you know, incredible offerings, but never any of these people were, you know, struggling or there was a difficulty in, or a challenge in doing it, but actually it was delighting their minds and delighting the minds of others. So the practice of giving is called Dāna in Pali. And then there's something called Anumodana. And that is another form of giving, of rejoicing. So you will say, whenever you see someone doing an act of kindness, you say Anumodana. Because you're rejoicing in the fact that they are letting go. You're rejoicing in the fact that they are giving, that they are bringing beauty to the world. All these, generating these wholesome qualities. So even though you're not doing the act, you can rejoice in others doing the acts. And this brings so much joy. So it's always wonderful actually being, you know, surrounded with Buddhists, because it's actually like a very happy environment. People are not like, I can't concentrate, so much suffering, but rather it's like, yes, this is lovely, yeah, oh, you're giving, I want to give too. Hey, how about you, Neil, do you want to participate in the giving? And Neil might go like, oh, I have nothing, even though he always has something, but it's not a good example. But then they're like, oh, it doesn't matter, here, it takes some of mine, so you can also give, you can also partake in this act. So we see how giving, you know, it's something very powerful. It's not just a utilitarian act. Well, the Sangha has these weird precepts. And so, okay, I need to make some time to give them some food, even though they're, you know, totally capable of growing their food, making their food. Perhaps one can have also some thoughts of these lazy monastics relying on lay people, you know, when they could actually get a 9-to-5 job. All sorts of ideas, right? My parents, for example, they're not born Buddhists, so they find it very bizarre that, you know, I took a vow of poverty and I don't have no money, and other people are giving me food, even though Italy actually has a history of monasticism, Christian monasticism, that used to practice this way as well, inspired actually by Asia, but that's another story. But all these things somewhat have gone in kind of in the back burner. And these days, even though there's so much wealth and more wealth than there has been all over the world, doesn't matter whether it's East or West, there's so much wealth and most wealth that there has been in history as we know it. There's also so much more stinginess, so much more craving. We can see it here in particular. And I think the United States is the wealthiest country I've ever lived in, or ever seen, really. Both lived and seen. Yet it's never happy. Never enough. The amount of mental health issues that are present in wealthy countries, actually also in Europe, I'm from Italy. The wealthier the countries, Scandinavia in theory is supposed to be on the top happy countries. It's not. It's happy in terms of GDP or whatever it is that whoever makes those statistics, you know, starts applying in terms of services, in terms of whatever kind of needs are met. But when it comes to mental health, then it's a whole other, you know, pool. So it's very interesting how also, like, you know, the meters that we use in society are very much based on material wealth, which absolutely, you know, we need certain requisites to that need to be met in order to just simply survive. But then how and why are we not happy when all of those are met, when all the sort of checks, we have this checklist, and then there's something, get to the end of it and we're like, well, I've got this and I've got that, I've got this and I've got that, what's missing? And so we can see how that's what the Buddha talks about, the craving mind. There is nothing that is ever inherently satisfying. We'll always look for more and more and more and more and more. That goes way beyond our needs. So it's interesting because we think also, once again, that even so, despite the evidence, right? Despite the accumulation of things that we have, and we see that we're still not happy, then the act of giving still is sometimes doesn't come natural, because we still tend to think, well, you know, I'm not happy having this, but I'm probably going to be even more unhappy if I let it go, right? Then I will be unhappy and without a cup. But right now I'm unhappy, but at least I have a cup. And so it's so interesting how counterintuitive the teachings of the Buddha are. So interesting how the more we let go, the happier we are. So interesting how the more we let go, the more actually we can appreciate things that we have. And that's also the practice that we do as monastics. That's why we take these vows of poverty. That's why we, you know, we only have one robe. I used to work in fashion, so I used to have significantly more stuff. My bosses back in Italy, they sometimes had an extra apartment to store all their stuff. This is why I quit, actually. I was like, I remember they were giving me a promotion, and I remember having this thought, in 10 years, I'm going to be like that. And I'm going to have probably another apartment in Milan to store my stuff. And I'm not quite happy right now. They don't seem quite happy either. So I'm not quite sure what I want, but I definitely don't want this, eh? But yeah, so interesting. So I didn't have another apartment. I wasn't that up in the hierarchy of the fashion world to be able to afford it or to have anything to put into another apartment. But definitely it was clear that that wasn't, happiness. And now that I have one robe and got rid of my Chanel bags, so much happier. Actually, it was so interesting. So I had these two Chanel bags that I was really like attached to. So I kept them right before I ordained. I was like very, I was not too attached to things, but those two things, I really like them. And even though I had been practicing Buddhism for a while, and actually I was already practicing in a renunciate level, so I wasn't really hanging out with my Chanel bags or going around with my Chanel bags. They were stuffed in the closet somewhere, in a suitcase somewhere. So when I ordained, I opened these remaining suitcases, and actually Bhante Sudaso was there, and he was like, all these heels and like fancy dresses came out. When I used to just go, he met me that I was, just going around like, in sweatpants and t-shirts, and he's like, where's this stuff coming from? And I didn't even imagine that you could wear them. Or these, well, he doesn't even know what Chanel is, but like, he was like, these like fancy bags. It's so weird. And I still remember how attached I was to those bags. And then I gave them to two friends. And I remember being so happy once I gave it to them. They were actually, both of them were like, is this fake? Because who in their right mind would actually, just give the Chanel bag, you're supposed to sell it at least. So that was interesting. But also what was really most interesting was my mind. The moment I let go of that object, it was the only time that that object actually gave me some sort of happiness. That I really experienced happiness in having a Chanel bag. And it was not because I possessed the Chanel bag, but it was because I had something that was perceived as precious, that someone else liked and that someone else then could enjoy, and that they were very happy to receive. And it was such a very profound teaching that now whenever I have an opportunity, whenever something is given to me, instead of, we have allowables, for example, the monastery, that we can eat afternoon. So monastics don't eat afternoon, but there are certain things, items that we can have. So one of them that is allowable is dark chocolate. And I'm one of the few monastics in the world, or people in the world, who does not like dark chocolate. Perhaps back in the day when I was a lay person, people would give me dark chocolate, I would go like, oh, terrible. But now instead it's like, oh great, how wonderful, now I have something to give to another fellow monastic who will appreciate it. So I'm happier actually to, when that is given to me, than something that I actually personally like. And that's not because I am special or particularly developed, quite the opposite, but rather because the teachings of the Buddha are experiential. Sometimes they're very, actually most of the time, they're counterintuitive, and we think we know better. And if we take the right attitude of not taking, things in blind belief, but rather as a working hypothesis, and perhaps also, we can go like, okay, I'm going to prove the Buddha wrong. Let's see if I'm going to do things the other way around, and I'm going to get the same results. Well, we'll see that over and over again, it's impossible to prove the Buddha wrong. You can try and try and try, and then you're like, accumulate, no, still not happy. Oh, I give it. Oh, I'm happy. All right, let me keep on giving. Oh, I'm happier and happier. Oh, let me let go of this and this other thing. Oh, happier and happier. And then you're like, oh, maybe I'll take some more precepts on. Happier and happier. And then you might, you know, side effect can be that comes with robe and haircut. that might happen. But yeah, it's a path of joy. The Buddha says as much. This path is, you know, beautiful at the beginning, in the middle, and in the end. So we don't have to wait until enlightenment fully, to be fully awakened, to experience relief from suffering. But actually, we can experience suffering, relief from suffering here and now. And whenever it's not a path of joy, then we need to evaluate what we're doing. Like, look, question, go to someone who is ahead of us in the path, perhaps, and ask for questions and see what we can alter and fix. And also see, it's also very, very good to be surrounded by people who are actually born Buddhist. I find it very helpful, because sometimes, you know, they won't give you a Dhamma talk. They won't perhaps even share, you know, the book, like read this or a sutta quote. But it's embodied, you know, it's cultural. Like, when I was traveling in Thailand, I don't speak one word of Thai, but there was, once again, this language. The culture is all entrenched with in Buddhism, and it's so beautiful to see that. You know, I had only experienced Italy, but that's my country, so I'm probably a little bit blind to that, where Catholicism is entrenched, like everything. The secular is, in every country, is inspired by the religious. So when you're surrounded by a Buddhist culture, then you start seeing certain tendencies of mind, you start seeing certain precepts that are just built in, embodied. And you can see how joyful it is, you know, how beautiful it is. And you can be inspired by going, oh, okay, yeah, I would be happy too. I want to beautify my mind as well and partake in this practice of joy. And it's accessible to everyone, wherever we are at our stages of awakening. We can all, yeah, we can all partake in this path of wisdom, of letting go in every single moment in our life. And then a happy mind gets easily concentrated. So we'll see that when we sit down and we start, you know, looking at the mind and doing the practice of holding our mind to an object, well, we have already primed the mind to be happy. So the mind will more naturally gravitate towards the object. This is what I was have been noticing in the retreat center that we had in Rockaway Beach. Over and over again, we'd have, you know, lots of converts that have been meditating for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, that would come and still deal with this restless mind. I would have, you know, a Thai friend or Burmese friend that some hadn't ever meditated, or some had, you know, meditated when they were teenagers and now they were in their 30s or 40s. And then they would sit, bam, like a rock. And I was like, how is this possible? It's like really bizarre state. And it took me a while to draw the connection. Well, it's not that they hadn't been meditating. They had, but just in a different way. And that had created really good conditions, a fertile soil where to then plant the seeds. You can have the best seeds, but if you don't have a good soil, then the plant won't grow. If you don't have the right conditions, the water to, you know, water it, it won't grow. So meditation is this, you know, formal meditation practice is this really good seed. But we need to also fertilize the soil. We need to create the conditions for it to be planted and to grow. And then it's beautiful, happy and peaceful in the beginning, in the middle, and in the end. These are just a few words. If you have any comments or questions, feel free at this time. I think we had an extra microphone, but I don't know where it's gone. Oh, it's here. Neo will bring it to you.
Do I have to press any button?
Okay. No, you're good.
I have a question about those Chanel bags. I was thinking, how lovely. It was a wonderful story. I was just wondering, when you gave those bags away and you felt so happy, did you also let your friends know that that made you happy?
Yeah, I think it was very visible in my mind, like from my face. I'm Italian, so I'm very expressive, I was told. So any kind of emotion is pretty straightforward and clear. So yes, absolutely. My friends saw it. One I knew very well. She's been one of my best friends from my previous life within this life. Here in New York, I mean, here in this part of the Northeast, you can call it. She's also from Italy. And the other friend, actually, I have met through Buddhist Insights. So she was fairly new in my life. And we all.
So I was curious if you had inspired them to continue giving it away.
I hope so. I mean, I haven't followed up. But I definitely, perhaps, I'm not sure. Actually, I'm pretty sure both individuals actually are very generous to begin with, so really kind people. So perhaps they had influenced me, who knows? We influence each other, but it's very important, yes. We were talking about it earlier, actually, with the residents here, of how it's so important to, you know, lead by example. We sometimes focus so much on how stingy everybody else is, but then are we actually generous ourselves? Or how, you know, angry people around us are, but we're probably, when we're complaining that people are angry, we're getting angry, you know? So there is, as Bhante Sumita the other day was saying, you know, whenever you're pointing out at someone, there are like four other fingers pointing at yourself, like, so so we focus very much on the one finger, but there's a lot here that needs to be worked on. And when we actually take the time, we do that recognition and we start working on ourselves, then actually we make so much more impact on others, because we're inspiring. Whenever we meet someone who is inspiring, we want to emulate them. We see it ourselves. I mean, the reason why I'm in robes is also because I met so many inspiring monastics. If I met all uninspiring monastics, I would have never wanted to become a monastic, right? So that's the nature of everything that we're doing. You know, if we are angrily doing anything, whether it's selling bread or, you know, partaking in activism, then hardly anyone will be interested in our bread or in our cause. But if we have done the work on our mind to then go out of things out of compassion rather than out of anger, out of care rather than out of spite, then people will be more interested in we can see it in ourselves. Yeah, we're like more, oh, okay, this, there is room for me to grow here. There's room for me to learn and do things. So absolutely, you know, I was sharing earlier with my friends here that our residents, how prior to the retreat center that we had in Rockaway Beach in New York City, I was very much into food activism of different sorts, but I didn't have a Buddhist practice, and my mind was full of anger, because it's very distressing, you know. Once you start reading about all the different anything, you know, you can, samsara is a whole cesspool of horrible things. So I had picked that particular subject, but if you get into, you know, there's so many different race, gender, any, you go. But you know, in that particular one, that was something that I was very much involved, and it was also, it also had impacts in so many other fields as well. But anyway, I think my success rate was minus 50%. I think I would alienate people who were interested in the cause to get on board because there was so much suffering. So we get upset at the suffering, so then we add suffering to the suffering, which is very counterintuitive. You know, as we were saying earlier, it's like there's a cake of feces, so you're like, let me add the cherry to it rather than do something about it. But when we started the retreat center, then, you know, I had learned so many different things. So then nothing was advertised as people should live a more sustainable life and not destroy the planet, or, you know, eat more plant-based foods or whatever you want to kind of share things along those lines. It was all about you're coming here to listen to the Dharma, and people would stay overnight. But it just so happened, as I said, that as I would like to say, that we vegan bombed them. So they would come, and surprise, the food is all vegan, and surprise, it's all mainly sourced from our garden. So we would grow things in the garden, and there were chickens who were free-range, rescue chickens, and they would meet the chickens and start relating to them no different than the cat, and start understanding that there was a different way of living, and experientially eating food that was not mass produced, that was not exploiting different people and different things. But because I wasn't lecturing anyone, interestingly enough, so many people, well, some, you know, turned vegan, some started just incorporating I mean, not eating meat four times a day or whatnot, or just being more caring and careful towards their choices, using less plastic, being more considerate about the environment, so many different things without me having to say a word. And it was such a profound teaching of, like, instead of focusing so much on what other people are doing, what are you actually contributing? So instead, they're, you know, out of necessity, because it was, you know, a Dharma center, so I was put in the position to give. I was a layperson back then. So, yeah. And it was the same, actually, with, you know, the organization always ran on donations. And at the very beginning, my mind, I was like, oh, well, there's very few donations. Oh, these people are so stingy. Nobody is donating. You know, I was a layperson back then. I was like, how are we going to pay for the rent? And how are we going to pay for this? And how are we going to do that? And then I had to reflect. I was like, okay, so everything, we say that everything is offered for free, and I'm calling everybody stingy because they're not giving donations. But then this is not really then free, you know? This is not the place that I am actually coming here. Am I actually being generous? Well, not really. I actually am thinking that, you know, I'm contributing all this work to the organization, and even though it wasn't that people were paying me or the donations were going to me, there's still that I give this, I contribute this, then I should, you know, create this amount of capital for the organization, say. And it was such an insight, you know, of how, yeah, we're constantly in this transactional way of perceiving human relationships. And once I caught that, and I was able to then go to it by saying, okay, I'm just gonna practice Dāna. This is my Dāna, so no strings attached. So I'm gonna give without thinking, like, whether Neil has given money in the box, or Harmit, I've seen him, you know, not giving anything, and, you know, what about the other person, like Angela, she, yeah, so in that way of categorizing people, eliminate it. You see the thought arising in the mind, destroy it, toss it. And I think that's why, actually, we were able to survive, because when you practice in accordance to Dhamma, then, if you protect the Dhamma, then the Dhamma protects you. So these are all insightful teachings of where we are I mean, not because I read it in a book, but rather because I saw it in my mind. So we need to take our minds as teachers, because our minds are full of goodness, but also full of a lot of crap. And we need to acknowledge the crap. We need to acknowledge the stinginess. We need to acknowledge the hatefulness. We need to acknowledge all those unwholesome qualities, not pretending that they're not there. Yeah, if we have racist tendencies in the mind, acknowledge them and go, these are disgusting. Let me do something about it. If we have sexist tendencies in the mind, we acknowledge them and we do something about it and we toss them out. But if we don't, if we pretend they're not there, if we pretend we're like perfectly enlightened, then there is no, you know, work to be done. You know, if you don't see the weeds in the garden and you pretend they're roses, you're not going to eradicate them. So it has to be a realistic path where we are very honest with ourselves. And actually, that's also how the Buddha talks about his practice. He would say that before he was an enlightened being, he would have these thoughts of greed, hatred, and delusion appear in the mind, and he would look at them, evaluate them, and then toss them. Actually, first he would contemplate, is this beneficial for myself? Is this beneficial for others? Is this beneficial for myself and others? And the answer is very clear. When it's something unwholesome, it's not beneficial for me, it's not beneficial for others, and it's not beneficial for myself and others. And so you see this passion coming in. You're like, oh, this actually, why am I so attached to this unwholesome thought? I can let it go. And then you feel much better. You're like, oh, that's great. So you make progress. But he wasn't like, oh, okay, no, those are ugly thoughts. I'm going to pretend they're not there. And yeah, I'm going to just pretend, you know, I'm full of loving kindness all the time and I'm great. No, we're not. Until we're fully enlightened beings, we'll still have a lot of unwholesomeness together with the wholesomeness. And it's okay to, in the respect of like acknowledging that that's the human experience, but it's not okay not to do anything about it. So we need to be proactive. So that was long story, very long.
It sounds to me like you said that if the giving is done in joy, then that's the gift.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Any thoughts from others? You can also say, I completely disagree and this is a bunch of nonsense.
I have a question, quick question. Are there any instances too that we use our wisdom in not giving? For example, like in New York, there's so many homeless people and you cannot really give every single one of them. And sometimes you're not really sure where they're gonna spend the money. For example, are they gonna buy food or are they gonna buy alcohol? When do we know, or when do we think it's best to give and not good to give?
Yeah, actually Bhante Sumita spoke about that a few weeks ago and it was actually quite lovely in the way that he shared this reflection. I'm gonna paraphrase it. That, you know, that's also a great opportunity to see how our mind works. So, you know, we talk a lot about letting go, but are we truly letting go? We tend to actually always follow up, right? Like, what are they doing with this donation? What are they doing with this thing? And is it wholesome or unwholesome? Well, it's none of our business. So our business is to give. That is the only duty that we should do. And by giving, we're letting go. If we worry too much on what people are doing with what we're giving, well, we're not letting go. We're following up, we're chasing and controlling. We should be realistic with what we can give. So the practice has to be always doing a little bit better, but not being too unrealistic. You know, if we have already, you know, trouble giving a cup away, we don't want to give our entire set of china away, right? That's a little bit of a stretch. It's kind of like You know, if you're used to stuffing yourself with food every day and then you want to go on a water fast overnight, it's going to be very difficult to sustain that. But if you gradually build up to it, then it will be more doable, that you're capable of sustaining whatever is your determination. So yeah, actually, as a layperson, for example, that's what I was doing. In terms of, I had actually noticed that I was very generous with food, I was very generous with things, because I knew, like, if I was giving, say, a cup to Angela, I knew that Angela then had a cup to use. Or if I was giving food to Angela, then I knew that Angela was going to eat the food. But if I had to give $50 to Angela, then I would go like, but I don't know what Angela's going to do with those $50. I'd rather decide for Angela what, you know, those $50 are going to. And at the very beginning, I was kind of blissfully ignorant about it and going like, oh, but I'm still like very generous because look at all this food and look at all these things that I give, kind of thing. But then I had to acknowledge it, as we were saying earlier, like, we want to see where is the stinginess? Because there's stinginess, and it's vice versa too, you know? There are people that are very, like, they will just write checks and checks, or money and money, but they won't make the effort to actually see what the person really needs, or... So those type of people will need to do that kind of practice. So we need to see in ourselves, where is it that the stinginess comes? So it's not one or the other. It's not exactly like the details of how it manifests, but rather where it manifests in ourselves. And then push ourselves. So then I was like, okay, well, how about today I just give $5, then tomorrow I'll give $6. Like, see where it, like, where is it becomes uncomfortable, and push a little bit more, and then go, okay, now 50, now 100, now 200, now 300, like, kind of thing. So you want to expand it. And it's the same thing. Perhaps, you know, you're like, oh, it's too much to figure out what such and such person needs. But maybe you can find something, a little need that you can fill. Maybe it can be just as simple as, oh, I'll be there and donate my time and listen to this person. I have trouble listening to people when they talk endlessly about their problems. Okay, so maybe not an hour, but 5 minutes of your time, you can do it. It's better if 5 seconds. So expanding our loving kindness, expanding our kindness, expanding our generosity, expanding. We always want to... Buddhist practice is a very ambitious practice. So we don't want to settle. We always want to grow and make more, build a bigger heart and more room for the heart to expand. But yeah, so I wouldn't, once again, we shouldn't be too concerned with what others are doing. Of course, if someone comes and asks you for money to buy heroin, or for you to go to heroin, you also don't want to do that. That's unwholesome. But if you see a person in need and your instinct is to give, give without following up. Don't be too... Yeah, it's none of our business what people are doing.
What about deciding the cause where it would make the most impact, right? So I was reading up or listening about certain places not having access to clean water, and if I donated over there, it would be providing clean water and wells, you know. Seems like that may be more impactful in alleviating a lot more suffering than, I don't know, like some other location that, while may put in good karma, you know, maybe giving may not be alleviating that level of suffering.
Well, I mean, I wouldn't be too mathematical about it, but rather what inspires you to give. So there are so many different causes. So, you know, there are people who don't have water, and also there are people who are lacking certain human rights, but they have water. So which one is the right cause? Well, each one is the right cause. So the right cause is the cause that you feel inclined to give, that makes you happy, and that inspires you to give more. And if you can give to many different causes, then great. But if you can't, then rejoice in your own goodness. So this is also a practice that the Buddha encourages us to do all the time, to do acts of kindness and then to think about them, recollect them, and pat ourselves on the back. It's actually a meditation practice, like recollecting our own goodness and recollecting how the devas, so angels, we can translate them, have these same qualities. Basically that we're angels. Whenever we practice, we cultivate wholesome qualities, we become divine beings. And so we can recollect ourselves as having the same qualities of divine beings. And you know, you don't have to be like ashamed or like be subtle about it, not arrogant either, but actually be really confident and proud of bringing goodness in the world, because you see the value of it and you see how powerful. If everybody cared about others, we would live in a much happier and better place, right? I think we can all be on board, whatever our opinions are, but you know, nobody wants to suffer, nobody wants to be discriminated upon, nobody wants to have be in a place of lack. And whenever there is compassion and care, then things come into being. So giving is always good. There is not one better than the other. It's whatever you are, if it's a beggar on the street, or if it's you know, giving to relieve suffering in another part of the country or in another part of the world, it's always a good idea. Yeah, pick whatever is in your heart. So perhaps that's all for this evening. So on Monday there will be the new moon Upasata. So it's traditional in Buddhist countries every 2 weeks to come to the monastery and take the 8 precepts and practice meditation the entire day. So if you want to do so, you're welcome to come on Monday for the new moon, and we'll be here from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. You're welcome to come for the whole day or just pop in whenever you can. And yeah, there will be meditation practice, some Dhamma talks, and food. There's always seems to appear food at 11 a.m. is when we have lunch, so that's usually to be expected. Yeah, so you're all welcome, and then we'll have once again meditation next week at same time, same place. All right, may you be all well and happy, and may all good things come to you.